Here are my favorite albums from 2022. Here we go again. The year is 2022. I know I said this last year, but I'm not gonna lie to you guys. This year we have been truly blessed by the music fairies, let me tell you. Honestly, this time last year, I really did think that my taste in music was pretty well developed, but 365 days down the line, I realized that I'd only seen the cusp of what the underground has to offer. And to be honest with you, there was so much stuff that came out this year that I was truly fighting for my life to put together a cohesive list that wouldn't make this video three light years long, bro.
A light year is actually a unit of distance.
Shut up. Anyways, a bunch of these, just a disclaimer, I'm probably gonna piss a couple of you off. But you know what? This is my channel, I do what I want. In this video, what am I gonna do, guys? I'm gonna talk about my favorite projects from the year 2022. I go by Ish, let's get weird. Jamie and Her Love Still Haunts Me Like a Ghost by Montel Fish. Right, so first of all, this character arc that this guy Montel Fish has been through over the past couple of years has truly been something. I'll be so real with you. He's gone from making gospel, bedroom pop, lo-fi music to this new character. Bro got his heart broken, I'm not gonna lie. And do you know what? It happens to the best of us. I'm gonna flex. I'm gonna take this time to flex. I've been following bro since he was preaching about, you know, not doing all of that stuff. You know what I mean? Back when he was on the whole Christian vlogging thing, you know. Anyways, Jamie was more of a light and acoustic oriented album, if that makes sense. It had more of a sort of denial and bargaining kind of vibe when it comes to the relationship. Her Love Still Haunts Me Like a Ghost, on the other hand, was more of the processing and coping with the loss of a recent partner. Anyways, my favorite tracks from Jamie were Jamie, Last Dance, and Darling. My favorite tracks from Her Still Loves Me Landscape Girl, you know. From Her Love Still Haunts Me Like a Ghost were Every Night, Escape, and Bathroom.
Ish, what about Hotel? Why isn't
Hotel on your list, Ish?
I'll be so real with you guys. Hotel went viral everywhere, but every single time, even when my first time hearing it was at the show. He played it, I was like, bro, this is The Hills by The Weeknd. And honestly, I can't listen to that song without thinking about The Hills by The Weeknd. But Montel did say that that song came from him experimenting and trying to develop his own sound. Look, either way, whether it was intentional or not, Montel, I know you're watching this right now. Be on my podcast, fam. We talked about this when we met. Anyways, we I digress. Next album that I'll be talking about is...
I was about to cut this part out as well, bro, but you know what?
I'm gonna keep it in. This is your sign to go drink some water, fam. Stay hydrated. I know your throat's dry as hell.
Alright, I'll be real with you. When it comes to The Weeknd, these past couple of projects, this guy's been pissing me off a little bit. This guy, Abel. And honestly, sometimes I wish this guy would just go bankrupt again. Be homeless like he was back in, like, 2011. Because I don't know what I'm gonna do if I don't hear Loft Music live ever in my life. But this guy's live shows, he's just doing up Heartless, Blinding Lights. I said, ooh, I can't keep living like this. I can't. Anyways, Dawn FM is the 7th album by The Weeknd. On it, he explores what it would be like to be stuck in a traffic jam going through purgatory after death. I wish I was joking. Now, don't get me wrong, this album probably has the most creative concept out of all of the albums on this list today. I can't fault The Weeknd for doing that. He's The Weeknd, he can do what he wants. But enough of the shenanigans, fam. Drop Trilogy the sequel. We don't want House of Balloons, fam. We want Mansion of Blimps, bro. Come on. We know what it's like to be outside, fam. Now we want to know what it's like to be inside. What I really love about The Weeknd is his ability to fully become a character. Like, that guy, like, just look at his Halloween costumes, man. This guy embodies every single character. Like, look what he did with After Hours. We talked about this last year. That guy dressed like a mariachi band member for the entire year. Like, in the music video for Gasoline, I really did believe that guy was an old man. Like, he embodies every character to the point where it low-key pisses me off. When he dropped the album cover, I thought it was joking. We know this. You guys watched the episode with Autumn XO. I know that because you guys are good, loyal fans, and you watch everything I post. My favorite tracks from Dawn FM are Gasoline, Is There Someone Else, and Phantom Regret by Jim. Just listen. Jim Carrey's voice in this album, the implementation of Jim Carrey fits so perfectly. This guy is a mythical character and he fit the album perfectly. Next album I'll be talking about is Magic City Thrill by James Tillman. So I actually discovered James Tillman back in 2020, and it was right after Modern Desires had been released. And honestly, Modern Desires low-key got me through lockdown. It really did open my eyes to what jazz could be, because whenever people talk to me about jazz before, I was like, what do I really want to hear a bunch of drums and J.K. Simmons screaming at people? What I love about Magic City Thrill is how upfront and direct it is in the way it conveys some of the themes explored in Modern Desires, both sonically and lyrically, to the point where it's almost not even jazz. It's more experimental, almost anti-pop, but it still has the fundamentals of jazz in it. The vocal delivery on some of these tracks, like Truth or Dare, Mr. Midas, all of these tracks, this guy can't miss. He has one of the most unique voices I've heard. He kills it every time. I'd be walking around listening to his music at night sometimes, and I'll just be stank facing, bro. And people walk past me sometimes, they're like, is that guy alright? Nah, fam, I'm just listening to a masterpiece. This guy James really did bless my ears this year. It's like his music just kind of makes me feel warm, you know? Which really helps because this album was released in winter. My favorite tracks on Magic City Thrill are It Was Love, Late Night Scramble, and Running Around. Masterpieces. Next album I'll be talking about is Cometa by Nick Hakim. This album, when it came out, okay, first of all, I heard Happen. We released it as a single. That song changed my life. It's one of my favorite love songs of all time. That guy changed my life with this song. This album as a whole is easily one of my favorite love albums of all time. Nick does his thing every single time. He deserves more as a musician. I don't know how, but the way I describe this album is, let's say you're at an open mic. You're at an open mic event at some random bar in, like, I don't know, like the sticks of London, like Camden or something. Don't come for me, Camden people. It just feels like an open mic kind of concert where the most unassuming guy comes up, picks up a guitar, and blows the fadunk of everyone's socks off. And you know what? Pitchfork, fam. Pitchfork, okay, first of all, Pitchfork lost their legitimacy a while ago. But they gave this album a disgracefully low rating. They attributed part of it to the album not developing the story enough. I don't really see why that's so important though, because music is art, and art is supposed to invoke a feeling, and this album does that perfectly. It invokes a feeling within the listener being me, and hopefully yourself as well. Personally, I don't think art is meant to be cohesive all the time. Nick invokes these feelings perfectly on everything he touches. Anyways, my favorite tracks on this album are, of course, Happen, the song that changed my life. It just ages. It goes so hard. Pause. Only One and Mark It. So the next album I'll be talking about is Gemini Rides by Steve Lacy. Let's go, let's get into it. First of all, I do have to give him his flowers because that guy is out here fighting for my rights. So, you know, respect to him for that. We Geminis need someone to take the mantle, especially since Kanye has been on, We don't need to get into all of that. It's just good to see someone trying to put us all into a good light. Because I swear, the amount of time... If you knew how many times I've been violated because I've said that I'm a Gemini, I'm mostly not a bad guy. Anyways, this guy Steve Lacy has had an interesting year. His live shows have...
Can you be quiet?
Been something. I wish I could have seen him live, but this guy's taking the piss with his ticket prices. Why is he charging £40 up for tickets? Chill, fam! And again, I'm gonna flex. I've been feeling this guy, Steve Lacy, pause, since he dropped Dark Red. But this new wave of fans is getting on my nerves. I talked about this on the TikTok video. It's ruining these underground artists. I don't know if I'd even call him underground anymore, but it's ruining these artists. Because how can you go to a concert and you don't know the lyrics to his biggest song? These guys are just like, I wish I knew he wanted me. Then when it comes to the what it do part, crickets. Crickets, fam. But we don't need to go too deep into that right now. Anyways, my favorite tracks from Gemini Rights are Not Bad Habit, fam. Not Bad Habit. Anyways, Amber, Cody Freestyle, and Sunshine. Next album I'll be talking about is Wasteland by Brent Faiyaz. We'll just give a special honorable mention to Indonesian Fantasies on the EP Too Late to Die by Sonda. Anyways, back to it. So this guy Brent, guys, he's a different caliber. This guy's been on the rise for the past couple of years now. What I love about Brent is his ability to make you leave his music feeling like a new man. Like, you could have just been rejected by a 2 out of 10 or something, just being down bad or whatever, but after listening to a little bit of All Mine or Price of Fame, you will come out feeling like a new man. That guy knows vocal layering like no other. The skits on this album are messed. That last skit on this album, Brent, sort yourself out, go to therapy or something, fam. Who can even come up with something like that? So on this album, of course, he talks about relationships, the kind of troubles that come with it, especially when you're living a fast-paced life, that kind of thing. Moving on, my favorite tracks from this album are Gravity, Heal Your Heart, and Loose Change. Next up, we have Polaris by OG Kemi. It's the first album by London-based rapper OG Kemi. He discusses fashion, women, and his upbringing over edgy, contemporary beats. And what I love about this album is the fact that it brings new ideas forward while emphasizing the great things about UK hip-hop. It's very weird. Kemi's one of those people, right? He's one of those people who has this weird ability to make everything he says on a beat just sound cool. I can compare him to a couple of artists, people like ASAP Rocky, people like Chavo, people like Skepta. Now just go with me on this one. I hate to say it, but people like Babytron. Like, they could be rapping about wetting the bed or something, bro. And you'd just be listening to it like, this is some heat, fam. Yeah. Anyways, my favorite tracks on this album are V for Veneta, They Didn't Need to Recast Aunt Vivian, Bro, and Why Does Stuff Always Go Left. He just knows how to pick a feature for a song. You know what I mean? He just knows. Next album I'll be talking about is Platinus by Bib Summer. Truthfully, Bib is up there with most talented artists that I found on TikTok. He's creating and developing his own universe through this music that he's making. So on this album, he discusses topics like fashion, ego, mental health, over sharp, sometimes sliding synths, and edgy 808s. With his signature cadence, flair, and flow, Bib Summer's flow is something else. My favorite tracks from this album were Oh So Mad. Those synths on Oh So Mad, they kind of take me back to those old, like, 8-bit games I used to play on, like, I don't know, like Mini Clip or Armor Games or whatever, way back in the day. My Ones, Solo Dolo, and finally CLC. And what I love about CLC is how Bib is able to talk about subjects that other people would see as corny, but in a non-corny way, you know? But it's always going to get commendations from me, and Bib, be on the podcast. I'm half joking, bro, right there. You don't need to, you know. But for real, be on the podcast. But anyways, moving on. Next up, we've got Capri Songs by FKA Twigs. So, streets are telling me this album isn't even an album, it's a mixtape. But even then, it still flames. There's elements of Afrobeats, there's elements of EDM, there's elements of some of her ballads from previous albums on tracks like Careless with Daniel Caesar. And speaking of Daniel Caesar, that guy needs to drop an album. Daniel, what are you doing? What are you playing at, fam? Listen, I haven't cancelled you. I don't know enough about the situation to... So... I haven't cancelled you, bro. I'll still listen to it no matter what comes out. Drop something, bro. Come on. Stop playing games. River Tippett just dropped something like 2 days ago. I know that's your guy. It's been 3.5 years. Come on. Anyways, on this album, FKA Twigs does her thing. She goes through topics such as self-acceptance, such as just dance, bro. Anyways, my favorite tracks from this album are Darjeeling, which is like a sort of drill track, Pappy Bones, and Jealousy, which is like sort of like an Afrobeats track with Rima. That guy's a menace from the clips that I've seen. I didn't know about him before this year. That guy's a menace. But anyways. My next favorite album of this year is American Girl by Kilo Keish. Kilo is truly my favorite feature artist at this point in time. She's featured on tracks with Gorillaz, Childish Gambino, Vince Staples, just to name a few. She kills it every single time. She puts her hands, feet, whatever into these tracks, bro. She kills it. And what I love about this album is the creativity of it. The story, like the initial story, where she's like in an arcade I love it. On this album, she explores themes of feeling boxed in by your own personal hindrances, feelings of trying to get out of the state that you're currently in, both physically and mentally, and encouragement and welcoming to the unknown. My favorite tracks on this album are American Girl. I love how sort of existential and hectic it feels. Choice Cowboy and Super KO Love. I love those tracks. This album's gonna piss a couple of you off. My next favorite is Good Movie by Pierre Bourne. Now relax, 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 relax. Okay, what I love about this album is how I just love when an artist is able to have fun on an album. You can tell that they're having fun. This guy spent like half of the song Hop On My Bed, like a whole minute in total, just repeating the lyrics, Hop On My Bed, bro. And it hits every single time, yo. I swear. I will say, this guy Pierre has got to get better on live performances. That guy is, I talked about it in the previous video. You know, you already know what I mean. Anyways, my favorite tracks on this album are Hop In My Bed, Kevin Hart, and Sane feat. Don Toliver. I'm recording this in post because I forgot to mention this in the video, but this guy Lancey been pissing me off, fam, because there's a certain line in Don't Talk that caught me off guard at least 3 times at the gigs I went to last year, fam. This guy says, stop bobbing your head to the beat, you dickhead, you don't. Bro, the song's hard, what do you mean? Do you want me to just stand there looking like a damn mannequin? And no one warned me! Every single time no one warned me and they were all just laughing at me, looking at me, ah, you dickhead, bob your head to the beat. Alright, so my next favorite album. First of all, the fact that I only discovered this artist this year is a violation. Lancey Foe, Life in Hell. Truthfully, this would probably be my second favorite album of this year. I will say the second half was definitely consistently better than the first half. That might just be the fact that not every single track needs to be punchy, yeah, 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 mosh, yeah, yeah. Like, sometimes I just like to chill and listen to bars, which I appreciate Lancey focused on in like the second half. And I'll be real, when I saw the features on this album, it got me hyped. Kate Renada, 070 Shake, a recipe for killer tracks. We don't talk about Jasta. We don't talk about that. I've tried. I really have tried. I'll be real, the first couple of times I listened to it, I was like, ooh, this guy Jasta, who is this guy? But nah, listening to it again a couple of days ago. Yeah. Well, this album is a concept. Explores the juxtaposition between the idea of living a fruitful and seemingly righteous life in the midst of what could be described as a chaotic environment. Just take that in. Lancey talks about it a lot in this one interview here. He goes into it a bit. And I'll be real, I only learned this the other day. If this album was all freestyled, I can only imagine what kind of thing Lancey could come out with if he fully wrote and conceptualized something the same way someone like, I don't know, like Kanye would take years making. Anyways, my favorite tracks on this album were Casino Royale / Thank You. To be honest, I did used to think that Thank You was a little bit corny, but after listening to the lyric, I really feel what bro is saying. High Grade, again, I needed to listen to this a couple of times. I went through a period where I was like, eh. But then afterwards, that guy has a lyric. He has some of the hardest bars of the year on this track. Man said, I ain't even walking on the beat, I still hip hop. Put some diamonds on my watch before I TikTok. Bang, bang, you can't miss, bro. And World on Fire. It's beautiful. Next album I'll be talking about is Once Twice Melody by Beach House. Throw a wild card into the mix, why not? On this album, they just do what Beach House does best. They create worlds, they layer sounds, they present new ideas, and I love that about them. On this album, they explore topic not too common to see in mainstream music nowadays. Now, whether I would call Beach House mainstream is another story, I don't know. I guess I would. If you do listen to this album, it's I'll be real, it's gonna take a lot of patience to get through. Well, you're gonna be sat there for a while. It's an 80-minute album. But hey, just be happy you're not listening to, what's his name? Was it Gucci Mane who dropped an 80-song album or something like that? It's 3 hours long. It's gonna take a lot of patience, but it's rewarding once you get to the end. The BPM of some of these tracks will have you thinking, yo, I swear this song has been going on for like 8 minutes now. Nah, 2 minutes in and the BPM is like 40. Anyways, my favorite tracks on this album are Superstar. I love the upbeat kind of feel. Pink Funeral. They just make me feel like I'm floating every time I listen to them, you know? And ESP. I really like the melodies in this track and the way Victoria vocalizes as well. Next album is How to Cry by Seifu. This guy Seifu spills his guts on the album from the jump. I've listened to this album on numerous occasions. It's one of those ones that just keeps me coming back to it for more, because I know that there are layers upon layers upon like it's an onion or something. I gain more of an appreciation for it every single time. There are so many bars that probably are still going over my head. On this album, he explores feelings of abandonment, lack of assuredness about the future, and just his upbringing in general. He talks about it all. It's a good album. My favorite tracks on this album are You Don't Know. The way this guy samples throughout the entire album, but even on this track, Chef's Kiss, Love of My Life. You can see the Kanye influences in the melodies. I love the old school gospel sample in the outro. And All I Have. The way the sample is used in this track with the trap beat. Again, Chef's Kiss. This guy knows what he's doing. He doesn't have enough monthly listeners. Seifu, I contacted you to be on the podcast. Be on the podcast, fam. The way the sample is used here with the trap beat is fresh. It's advanced. Mixing trap with folk slash reggae is a combination I never thought I would need to hear, but he pulls it off so well. All right, you know the vibes. Before we get into my favorite album of the year, we're gonna do some honorable mentions. So yeah, producer, run the thing. There's no producer in here. I don't know why I said that. Anyways, my favorite album from the year 2022 is You Can't Kill Me by 070 Shape. Alright, see this woman Danny, guys. Danny Moon, bro. She's doing something different. And for all intents and purposes, after I saw 070 Shake live in September, my life hasn't been the same. After I left that show, I felt like a different person. The atmosphere was electric. It was great. Shake came out onto stage with a bottle of wine and a wine glass and was just sipping it the entire time. I came to find out afterwards there was a pretty good reason why she was doing that. In You Can't Kill Me, it addresses romantic turmoil, blending rap and R&B. In a cathartic and liberating way. You can really feel the strong Ye, Cudi, Mike Dean, all of those influences in this album as a whole. And what I love about albums like this is when the artist is willing to put their ego aside and just let it all out for 45 minutes for millions of people to hear. Every single track, not even exaggerating, literally every single track on this album is a hit. The production is miles ahead of Modus Vivendi. Layers upon layers. You can feel the work that went into this album. This is velvet, bro. This is blue velvet. Layers of instrumentals, vocals, effects, all of that just add to the quality of this album. This album is to mainstream music what jollof rice is to plain white rice. Just let that digest. No pun intended. Everything that gets put into every track creates this feeling of almost release that you can feel as a listener. You can tell that it's been clearly lifted off of Danny's back as she released this onto the album. My personal favorite tracks from You Can't Kill Me are Medicine. It's the perfect fit for my previous description from before about the release. Cocoon, of course, the drop in this track. It gave me a chill the first time I heard it, and I had to replay the song like 5 times. Seifu La Luz, a perfect conclusion to this release of thoughts and concepts. It was just beautiful. Danny singing in Spanish. Love to hear it. That pretty much concludes this episode of Airing Cupboard. You guys better make sure you go and like the video, subscribe. Actually, like and subscribe, please. Also, comment any albums or EPs that you think I might have missed. Let me know. Keep it real, and I will see you later, alligators. Time to run the credits.